director of the film Pan, Joe Wright. And making his big screen debut as Peter Pan, Levi Miller. Playing Hook before that Hook, Garrett Hedlund. And last but of course not least, the Wolverine. We know the world of Peter Pan, we've seen films, we've read the books. So I really want to hear how this specific immersive world that you created, this Neverland, is going to be different from the ones that we've seen in the past.
Well, it's really sort of Peter Pan for 2015, and it's a complete reframing of the story as we know it and love it. It's a big world, and it's beautiful and bold, and this is all an origin story of how Peter became Pan.
How fantastic. Tell me quickly, guys, what you thought of Joe's vision for this world when he first articulated it to you. Levi, why don't we start with you?
An absolutely beautiful script, and when I met Joe and I spoke with Joe with the rehearsal stage, it was... The vision of his character was an absolutely perfect idea, and mm-hmm. best one I couldn't have thought of it.
That's awesome. How about you, Garrett?
When I first met Joe, he said, you know, I have a young son that's been having nightmares, and he said, I want to make this film as dark as I possibly can to show every kid out there that no matter how dark the fear, they can overcome, you know, the nightmare and what they're afraid of. And I thought it was one of the most, you know, beautiful things I'd ever heard.
Yeah, that's exquisite.
I can guarantee you're going to see Neverland like you have never seen it before through Joe Wright's eyes. The guy, as you all know, is a visionary. And one thing you may not know by seeing it, you probably presume it's all green screen. It was not. Joe likes to build a set. So Neverland was a set. It was in a hall. I'm looking here. This famous hall is probably three times the size of this space.
Wow.
Right? Was a studio we shot it up in Cardington, where Nolan did all the Batman movies and Inception, and it was incredible. The first day I got on set, I was all dressed up, and I went out to go and find Joe. They said, Joe wants to have a look. So we went out with the AD, or the second AD. He couldn't find Joe on the set. It took about 15 minutes. He was lost under some mushroom somewhere. Not that kind of mushroom.
Or maybe it was.
I don't know, Joe. There's a lot of music playing, but anyway. It was 4 a.m, I don't know why. But anyway, this guy's a visionary, and it was all our joy and pleasure. I don't know if we'll ever get to make movies like that again, so.
Do we want to take a look at a little bit of the
film? Yeah, we have a new trailer to show you guys. You're the first people to see this, I think. So let's have a look at this trailer.
So, we talked a little bit more about, a little bit before this, about this is such a different vision for this world, a different vision for how all the factors in Neverland come together and break apart, and it looks incredible. I guess, also, Hugh mentioned that you built huge practical sets, and I wonder if that was something that you decided to do early on in the creative process, or if once you started to figure out how you were going to shoot the film, it made more sense to go with practical sets versus green screen and CGI, which most people would do for economy.
No, I'm not sure that it would have been less expensive doing it in CGI. Mm-hmm. And the really big set was the forest, and a lot of action takes place there with the village and everything. And I just felt that it would give us more of an immersive experience making the movie. It would help Levi, whose first movie this is, to understand where he is and the world he's in. and also helped me, to be honest, to understand where I was. I love building physical things, you know. I love building playgrounds for us all to play in, and so that was the idea of the set. Yeah.
Did it feel like a playground to you, Levi?
It did.
Yeah.
First time I went there, it was like you've walked into another theme park. It was full of all these different and cool things. It was mind blowing.
Hugh and Garrett, you guys have both worked extensively with green screen. I mean, Tron, I think you've just been in a room, probably. Just a green room for 3 months.
Some sets.
So how did this feel as actors to be able to work in this practical world?
It was great. It was, I mean, like Hugh was even saying, every day was pretty magical. You know, Joe certainly has his way of keeping the morale up within the crew, and he'd be playing music. And we, you know, on most days we'd have 150, 200 extras, and, you know, every day they're dancing and singing. All the crew's dancing and singing. It was something that, you know, Joe and I both kind of laughed at a lot of films sort of before this. We've done a lot of sort of depressing or very dark kind of stories, and this was an opportunity to sort of have as much fun as we could and enjoy the filming experience as much as we could, which we felt was sort of a rarity and what we were sort of lacking. So it was definitely a playground. It was fantastic.
Awesome.
This is one of the most fun movies I've ever made. Joe set the tone. There's music playing all the time. Everyone had a great time. I mean, we're shooting Pan. We're in Neverland. By the way, the pirate ships, full scale, fully built. There were four pirate ships built with it. We had four pirate ships in a space about the size of this hall. It was incredible, the costumes, and even down to rehearsals. I mean, a lot of directors don't rehearse. Joe had 3 weeks of rehearsals. He had all the pirates in a room. There was a box with clothes, and he said, "Okay, guys, go and dress up, make up your costume." So for the next 3 hours, that's what we did. We did improvs. It was, the whole thing was a complete joy. The
thing was, though, what was in those boxes were only dresses.
Yeah.
They weren't, no pants.
Yeah. Yeah. We used it again at the rap party. It was fantastic.
Well, I think we have some additional footage to take a look at.
Yeah, we have some exclusive new footage for you to look at. No one's seen this before. I believe it is the introduction of Blackbeard to the film. So it's Hugh's introduction. And yeah, let's take a look.
Including the fact that Blackbeard's crazy limber.
There are clearly no dentists in Neverland.
But there is hand disinfectant.
Exactly. Yeah, he's pretty crazy. When I first met Joe, he said, you know, here's an image I have in mind for Blackbeard, and he showed me a picture, which was my face superimposed with the wig of Marie Antoinette and the costume of Louis XIV, and I was like, I'm in. It's as crazy as Neverland should be, and every part of it. I remember Joe explaining to me that if you assume that Neverland is a child's imagination, that adults should always be somehow frightening and ridiculous at the same time, which is generally how kids see us. So, which is right, Levi. We are frightening and ridiculous, right?
Yes.
You meant to say no to that. Anyway. But it was all Joe's sort of world and his vision from beginning to end.
It's exciting also to see the fearsome pirate being someone other than Hook. I mean, Hook is really sympathetic. You can see, at least in this beginning part of it, that he's a different guy. So it'll be interesting to fall in love with someone who we've spent all this time hating in this context. Seems pretty sweet, your Hook.
Give it time.
Let's get an audience question in here. Come on over. Poison Ivy.
Hi, I'm Cheryl from New York. Obviously, when there's a lot of sources of Peter Pan. I realize that you all wanted to create your own identity, but was there anything that any of these sources that you went to for inspiration in creating your roles? Thanks.
Thanks.
The main source material for the movie was Barrie's book, Peter Pan. And for me, the main inspiration from that book was a sense of its strangeness. It's a very odd book. It doesn't underestimate the children's intelligence and is quite dark. But also the characters, there are no real goodies or baddies. Even Peter is quite flawed. He is brave and bold, and he also and a lot of fun, but he's also he steals other people's ideas, and he thinks he's above reading and writing, and in the end he stabs Hook in the back in a quite dishonorable way. So I really loved the kind of duplicity of all the characters, especially Peter, but also Hook and Tiger Lily and so on.
We, guys, this is awesome. We have to move on. And so I want you to give a huge round of applause to the team.